A researcher is interested in conducting research which falls into quantitative methodologies. And for that, for data collection, he or she plans to use certain tools for data collection. Now, some of the tools we have already listed as questionnaire, interview schedule, observation schedule, checklist, rating scale, etc. We have also seen what interview, what is an interview and what are its types. What is an interview? Interview is a process by which the interviewer brings out the opinions and thought processes of his or her respondents. What are they thinking about a process, a product, or an event, or a phenomena, whatever the interviewer is interested in. We also discussed about various types of interviews. Now we will see how to create or construct an interview schedule and interview guide, and then naturally how to use it and how to be careful in using interview as a tool for data collection. Now we want to plan and construct an interview schedule and interview guide. There are some steps involved in it. The first step is state the purpose, why you want to construct an interview. Please understand that this refers to the objectives of the research and research questions and also the hypothesis if they are stated. So the researcher once again has to visit the objectives and hypothesis for preparing the interview schedule. The second step is to review related literature. As someone else used some kind of tools like interview schedule before, how did they collect the data? What kind of questions were asked? All these things, what kind of sample was selected? These are very vital things for preparing any interview schedule. So to understand, the researcher has to study the related literature. The third step is selecting a sample. The researcher must know to whom he or she is going to interview. Who are these people? So the sample has to be identified. I am not saying exact number of sample, how many people, but who are these people and from where we are going to select them? What is the population of it? If we know that, then creating or constructing a tool like interview would be a little easier. The fourth step is to create or structure the interview. For this structuring of interview, we are designing various sections. Then the step comes where we frame questions, which questions we would ask. Once this is done, then we prepare interview guide. And there is a process for validation, for finding out the reliability, for pre-testing. All these processes are applicable to all types of tools which are also applicable to interview. Let us see each step in detail now. The first step for preparing, constructing interview schedule is stating the purpose. When we state the purpose very clearly, it is easier for us to structure the interview because the kind of structure which is required for purpose will differ if our purpose differs. What type of interview schedule to be used, whether it is structured or semi-structured or non-structured, unstructured interview, all these depends on the statement of the purpose, why we want to create this tool, what kind of data we want to collect and from whom. So stating a purpose is very important. Second step, we already discussed about it, reviewing of relevant literature, which would give us a wide idea, perspective of what is already been done. The third step is selecting a sample. Sample selection is very important. We should not be, because interview technique is generally used with survey method. And now if you only go for 4 or 5 or 10, such a small sample, then it may pose some problems or challenges. So if it is possible to have larger sample, then go for it. It is very essential that the researcher takes consent of the sample, the respondents, because the respondents must know what is coming, what we are going to ask them, and whether they are ready to answer these questions. We will discuss this once again when we are going to discuss about how to conduct interviews. But here it suffices, because if you know what kind of sample is you are going to select, then what kind of questions also can be framed accordingly. The next step is structure of the interview. Interview schedule is a full-fledged tool which has introductory part, which has main body of questions, and which also has concluding part. Now, when you are structuring it, you must know what you are going to say in the beginning. Then the questions, of course, we will design questions later, and how you are going to conclude. The introductory remarks create rapport with your respondents, and concluding remarks also show the respect for the respondents. So keeping that in mind, a whole structure of interview schedule is prepared. At this stage, we also must know how we are going to code. Are we going to give alternatives so that we can just give the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4? Or if it is going to be open-ended, we must know how we are going to code the answers or the responses. At this point of time, we also may give a thought how we are going to score it. Not exactly, once the schedule and the guides are ready, then we can actually score it. But here at this point of time, if we are not clear what kind of scores we are going to give and also what kind of data analysis we are going to do. Otherwise, what happens? We prepare the tool, we administer that, we collect the data, and the researcher doesn't know what to do with this data. This should not happen. We have to be very clear at this stage how we are going to analyze the data, because then the scoring can be done accordingly and naturally the structure of the interview would change. Next step is, naturally, now your structure is ready, so you will start preparing the questions. Now, interview schedule has different sections. For example, first section can be about preliminary information about the respondent. If you are interested, your variables are age, gender, family income, socioeconomic status, then questions related to that should be asked. If you are going to keep anonymity, the name need not be written on that. But what is the age? Exact age need not be asked. Then we always give the range from 15 to 20, 20 to 25, like that. So that if you prepare these categories, then it is easier to code them. So each question is framed now at this stage. They are again and again studied, read, and if found correct, then only included in the interview schedule. We don't want so many questions to be bombarded on the respondents. So we have already seen that we have to keep it to the minimum. Nobody would like to discuss for 2-3 hours. So keep it to minimum, but you must get whatever information or data which you require to work on your studies, work on your objectives, work on your hypothesis. The wording of the question should be such that the respondent understands what you want to ask. They should not be ambiguous or vague. So language is very important. It should not be a high-flown language also. It should not be a very complex and compound sentence. It should be very simple so that the interviewee, the respondent, understands what you want exactly from him or her. Once these questions are ready, this is called interview schedule. Now, interview schedule is one thing and interview guide is another thing. Interview guide is for the interviewer to use and put tick mark there or put their comments and then get the next cue and everything. So this is called interview guide. So we will see what interview guide is. So once the structure, these questions, the sections are ready, then we go for interview guide. That is the next step. As the name suggests, interview guide is used for guiding the interviewer. Now, it's not always that only researcher will go and interview. The researcher can generally appoint field investigators who will be trained, of course, to conduct interviews. So for everyone to understand, everyone to be on the same plane, we need to prepare certain rules. And this guide, interview guide, has all the statements, how to do, what to do, all these suggestions, all these statements are included in interview guide. When we prepare a guide, all the questions are standardized now, because the same guide will be given to all interviewers and the same questions will be put forward to all the respondents. So they are standardized. and even the instructions are standardized. In the guide there are instructions. Please ask this question. If the answer is yes, then go to question number 11. If the answer is no, go to question number 17. These kind of instructions are written in interview guide so that it is easier for the interviewer to follow those instructions and conduct the interview in most profitable and effective manner. Interview guide also states what opening remarks to be made, how to create a rapport with minimum words, so and how to put the respondent at peace, because if they are agitated, if they are angry, if they are annoyed, then the interview will not be in good condition. So it is very important that we create a rapport and what kind of opening statement should be made so that your request to them, your respect for their time, for their opinions, for their thoughts must be seen through this. And that is why opening remarks are very important. And interview guide contains opening remarks. Similarly, the closing statements are also equally important. We have to thank the respondent. We may have to say that if you want to come again, or if you want to say that this will be kept strictly confidential, you have already said that, but you want to repeat that. So all these statements come into closing statements. So closing remarks are also very important, and a good interview guide will also have this. It's not that you have to say it mechanically, but these are the things which the interviewer must say while closing the interview so that the good relationship continues with the respondent. The interview guide also has some special characteristic. One of that is its structuredness. When it is structured, it should use minimum required alternatives. It requires minimum things for the interviewer to write, because if he or she gets involved into writing what is said, then the attention to what is being said, some of the things may be lost. So we have to, in the interview guide, all these things are apprehended. We think that these can be probable answers. All those answers, even if they are 8 to 10 answers, we should list them out so that it is easier for the interviewer to just to tick mark. So interview guide has this, all these alternatives. And how do we get these alternatives? We will see, because we have to do pre-testing. We will come to that a little later. Unless we do that, these questions and their responses will not come. How we frame these questions? Before that, I mean, of course, review of literature is done. But we also talk to people, probable sample. But we will not select them in sample because they are already been talked to. So what we do, we select some people who are probably they can be in the sample, talk to them, get to understand what are the probable responses, which would help you that if I ask this question, see, 10 people are giving 10 different answers. So all those alternatives can be included in your interview guide. But keep this in mind, when you go for testing, again 11th answer can come out. Many answers can come out, because if you are keeping any opinions open-ended, naturally people have different opinions. But that does not mean we should not prepare a list of probable answers. So interview guide should make writing part to minimum. Most of the probable alternatives should be listed in interview guide. Sometimes we said that if it is semi-structured or unstructured interview, probing is done. And when you do probing, what kind of questions should be asked? Probable questions for probing, they also must be listed. The interviewer should not start asking something out of his own mind. The standardization is very important. If the probing questions are asked, different probing questions are asked by different interviewers, then this standardization is not maintained. And because the probing can be done in a different manner, the data will be of different types. We don't want that. So interview guide also contains probable probing questions. The third important aspect of interview guide is the language of questions. The researcher may tend to use jargons, and the respondent may not know about this. Then what happens? The jargons are not understood, and the responses given may be tangent to what you want. So it is always better to keep the language to simple. That doesn't mean that you have to sacrifice your professional thing. If you are, say, if you are interviewing CEOs of companies, naturally they are CEOs, very high level professionals and leaders. With them you can use the professional language, the jargons. But if you outdo that, then people also get averted to it. So language, use of language in interview guide is very important aspect of any good interview schedule. Once your interview guide is ready, there are two more steps before you start using it. You have prepared the questions as a researcher. Now, its content validity has to be established. So you select five experts from the field who know your subject and who are also well conversant with the tool, research tool, that is interview schedule. You send these to these five people and get their feedback. Sometimes it happens, you have framed a question and then they do not know why this question is here, what is the meaning of this question, it may give something, some other response. When the researcher starts writing the questions, his mind is fully occupied, and that's why sometimes some of these errors may be overlooked. So it is always better that we establish the content validity, we send him these objectives. These are our objectives, these are our hypotheses, and this is the tool for you will be used for collecting data. Then the experts also see the relationship between objectives and the tool. Sometimes it happens your objectives are one and you are asking some other kind of a data which is not really relevant or related to your objectives. Such questions need not be asked. So the third person sees this. Sometimes it also happens that you have a particular hypothesis and questions which you have asked, suppose you have asked a set of five questions which are inadequate. So experts may tell you that in order to test this hypothesis, you also need two more questions and these are those. So getting this feedback from the experts would help you to modify, to change the interview schedule in a proper perspective. Sometimes it happens that you don't agree with the feedback, leave it. But most of the time, it is good that we establish content validity by giving it to five experts. Their feedback most of the time is very valuable. Now, after getting the feedback from the expert, you have modified that and your tool is ready. Interview guide is ready. Can you start using it on the sample, real sample, whom you are going to select for your study? I don't think so. Because again, this is not being tested in the field. So it is advisable that we select similar sample, because these people will not be included in your study, but they are similar. If you were to select this sample, this was the sample. You select that sample and then administer that to them. You ask the questions in a way you would be conducting. This is called pre-testing. Pre-testing of the tool, interview schedule. How you are going to give the opening remarks, how you are going to ask the questions, how you are going to take a pause, what kind of probing questions you will be asking, how much time you are taking, because that will also give you some idea whether it is taking 15 minutes or 2 hours. You may be thinking it will take only 15 minutes, but when you actually go in the field, you see that the kind of probing which is required, the way people respond to you, the time may differ from 15 minutes to 2 hours. So then again you have to come back and modify your questions or the structure accordingly. So pre-testing is very important. Now if your sample consists of rural and urban both, and if you do pre-testing only on in your city, what will happen when actually you go to rural villages, people, rural areas, you will find that they are not able to understand what you are asking. This happened with me. When we prepared a tool which we wanted to test, when actually, of course, we thought of pre-testing it in a village as well as in rural areas, these were on the teachers. When we did this pre-testing on municipal schools in Mumbai, we got very good response and we were very happy. Our tools is ready. Tool is ready, tool is effective. It takes so much of time. Then we went to village near Badlapur. We started interviews with the teachers and they started asking us the questions. What is this? What is that? What does this mean? Because we had thought that the teachers would know this, which the rural teachers in that area did not know. In many other areas, they may be much better than the city teachers. But in the area where we went for testing, we found that our language was not really coming across. So we had to come back, modify our language and do the pre-testing once again. This is very much required, because if you really want to collect data to test your hypothesis, to check your objectives, then the researcher has to take these trouble. You have to invest your time and energy to make your tool flawless. Otherwise, the tool which you use, if they don't understand, if they give any answer, then your data is affected. When we do the pre-testing in the real setting, this also tells you whether the language which we have used is correct, appropriate, understood. If they ask you questions, I have not understood what it is, then you have to modify that language and then see that, because respondent must understand what you want to ask them. So language is intonation. How to ask, that also makes a difference. So when you are pre-testing it, a lot of things are understood by the researcher, by the interviewer, so that you come back to your table, modify those, and then your tool will get more towards, it will move towards perfectness. I'm not saying a tool is perfect, because there is always an opportunity, always a room for modification, improvisation. But now you are thinking that this is good enough to go for data collection. If you find that the sample from rural areas or sample from urban areas, they are not able to comprehend what you are asking them, then you have to come back, modify based on this feedback, modify your interview guide, and then make it foolproof.